were saying that scene when you were having the
very
fight.
Effective.
How did they do that? How did they get that blood to come out of your nose like that?
The next morning I arrived at work and the girl at reception said, I believe you broke Amanda Muggleton's nose.
No, I wasn't. Wait till I get her. It was just fractured. You know, it was just a really bad...
I kept saying to you, don't put your head down, don't put... Because at that point, we were choreographing our own fight scene.
Yeah. How? By letting the women do what they like? It's amazing that more things didn't go wrong.
Well, actually, when they had a stunt coordinator in, it's for a scene that... Fiona Spence had to do. She broke a little finger. Try telling that to Mrs. Davidson. At least one, you know, only one nose broken. It's all right.
Any suggestions? Keeping in mind that we're the ones that get the blame if something goes wrong.
We have to be given free rein in controlling the women. It's as simple as that. And we have to insist that Mrs. Davidson supports us.
All those fabulous meals. Do you remember those? Macaroni cheese. I got so sick of it.
Sometimes we used to get chips, didn't we? We'd all hoe into the chips.
Yeah, but if we had decent food, the extras would eat it all on the first take.
They did.
And if it was really good, then the crew would get in as well.
Occasionally they get, look at that mush. Please, sir, can I have some more? Terrible stuff.
Something's up. Yuck.
And it used to be cold. By the time you did the take, it was all cold anyway.
That's right. And fairly unpalatable to start with.
Some of that meat was all gristle, wasn't it? Look at
what's she doing?
She is now, Yentosov is now a vocal coach. For doing it phonetically, you know, helping people raise their voices, lower their voices, correcting speech impediments.
She's a very clever girl,
she
actually.
She is clever. She's a great girl.
Now, see, that set, do you remember what it was also used for? It was the dining room, it was the recreation room.
Everything. They just used to change the whole set. Mm.
It was the library as well.
Yeah.
You're not kids, you know. You're supposed to be mature women.
Oh, thanks for noticing.
You tell them, Fletch.
The only thing I've noticed, Brian, is you're headed for trouble.
Mr. Big Fletcher, trouble. There are two knives missing.
Right, where are they?
Search me.
She was a great character too, that extra there in the brown jumper. One at a time,
Miss Bennett. You and Officer Powell, search them thoroughly.
She was always there from the beginning. The rest of you up against the wall, hands where we can see them.
The first person to move or talk will be straight into solitary. And that brown jumper there,
yeah,
that's Barbara Youngworth.
Barbara, that's, of course it
she
is.
Ended up with actual dialogue. She ended up...
Yes, she did, yes, later.
With words to
and
say.
And the little blonde is Judith somebody, the girl that died. Judith.
Oh, yes.
Lorimer? No.
Judith Lorimer, you're right.
Am I right?
Yes.
She was lovely, and her husband was lovely too. They they had an amateur company.
That's right, they did.
Of vaudeville and...
Yeah, music hall.
Music hall.
Mm. Responsible. It's up to you.
I have to say that they did look stupid, didn't they, the screws? They were never given real power, were they?
Well, I have to say also that on one occasion... one of the prison officers was complaining about the fact that all they were ushers. Actually, it was Meg Morris, Elspeth Ballantyne, saying, all we do is usher you into the laundry, usher you into the recreation room, usher you into the dining room. We're nothing
around.
But ushers. And I said to her, well, after all, darling, the show is called Prisoner, not Screw.
No, but eventually they gave them good storylines, didn't they?
Oh, they did.
I used to love that story with Fiona at Vinegar Tits when you saw her, how she lived on her own.
Oh, yes,
how sad she was, and she was drinking on her own.
You remember when they brought her little dog in? It wasn't her, it was Vera found a little dog, I think, that's right. And it was actually her real dog, little King Charles Spaniel.
And she bred them, didn't she?
Yes, right, she did breed them, and she locked it, had to be locked in a cupboard. And it was supposed to cry and whimper, and it wouldn't, so I did the voiceover for it. I didn't get paid any extra either.
Stop it, Val.
I should put that on my CV, shouldn't I? Whimpering. Mrs. Davidson.
dog whimpering.
But if we don't break these women now, we can't answer for the consequences.
I don't expect you to. However, I do expect my staff to remain calm. And as far as breaking the women is concerned, I will not tolerate that sort of attitude from any officer. I must say, I'm beginning to wonder just who is breaking whom.
There she is, pinching all our good stuff again. Oh, give me back my knitting.
Back
to go. Bitch.
Oh, Miss Bennet!
It's a wonder I missed it the first time. It could be broken and used as a cutting instrument.
Lizzie.
This is classified as a weapon.
Oh, I don't know why you don't take everything and get done with it.
I thought they did that a few scenes ago, took everything. Not much left to take.
Yeah, I know.
Now you know why the wolves are bare.
Yeah. Poor Sheila's arm and hand.
Mm.
She smashed it very badly, didn't she? She fell.
Actually, I believe that was from her being blown through a window in a blitz
in
London.
In London, yes. That's why her, if you look, she's always protecting her arm, and it's always crooked. It's terrible.
Well, there's absolutely no feeling about through her fingers.
No.
Like rubber, that's right. So she had to learn to write with her left hand afterwards. So there. Now that lass, the other lass with the dark hair,
yes.
I cannot remember her name. What I do remember is when she left the show, she wasn't earning enough money and she had a single mother all of a sudden. We were racking our brains trying to think what to give her, and Betty Bobbitt said, really, really what she needs more than anything is money.
Money. We had a whip
round. So I said, I've got an idea. We had a whip round. We actually raised quite a lot of money, and I went to a floral shop and I got a big one of those big cellophane boxes, and I made all the flowers out of money. And put it in a box, and you know, when she first received it, and to put other fern and stuff, she just thought it was flowers, and she realised that every flower was like a $20 note, or a $50 note, or a $5 note. Poor darling burst into tears.
Yeah, she did.
Because it's so hard giving someone money. You know, it can be embarrassing.
Well, they were with us from the beginning, some of these extras, weren't they?
They were, indeed. Mm. They were an integral part of the show.
Repairs to all the equipment you have damaged.
There she is, Erica, laying down the law.
See, it's one shot as well, so she had a lot of dialogue.
She did have a lot of dialogue, and it was usually monologue too, because she didn't have anyone to share the responsibility with.
Mm.
Is that clear? It may interest you to know, I had intended finding a replacement for Mr. Andrews as quickly as possible. However, if this is the sort of behaviour you're going to present, then I have no alternative but to drop the matter.
Well, the screws are going to get rid of him too, so what's the point?
Yes! Stick it, Mrs. Davidson! What you give with one hand, you take away with the other!
Well, you can't promise nothing, because you've got to do what the screws tell you to do.
Then we don't trust you anymore anyway, so there!
Onward, prisoner sisters, marching as to war, cause the screws of windward treat us oh so poor. We
were working very, very fast too. I don't think a lot of people appreciate just how fast we were churning this stuff out.
And
two episodes a week.
And,
I mean, what's the most takes you ever did?
I can tell you exactly. It was a Friday night, and they'd left.
It's always Friday because we're so tired.
You
were laughing, weren't you?
Oh, of course I was. It was the most ridiculously written scene, and it was Julianne Newbold and I, and they'd left this scene. It was a very big scene to the end of the day, because they thought, oh, well, these two are the professionals, you know, we'll leave them to the end because they'll do it really quickly. We're both in bed, it's semi-dark, and the script, it was actually Kendall
in bed together?
No. No, we were not lesbotic in that cell. Other cells, yes. Kendall Flanagan was directing again. And of course, the three cameras were due at 6 o'clock to go over to the newsroom. And so we had to get this scene done.